So we defined an image, and here is a mathematical definition. I mean, it's a function from spatial 2D spatial domain R2, right? Because it's a spatial function, as we see here in this image. X and Y are the spatial coordinates. And for instance, this is, let's say, X equals 200, Y is 400, I of XY is taking the value of 178. This is a one band, single band image, single channel image. We call it grayscale, okay? X and Y are the spatial variables, I is the intensity. I think this is clear. Probably most of you have worked with at least some image processing, but maybe not, don't worry. Typical camera, maybe some of you are photographers, you guys know what I'm talking about here. Here is the sensor I was talking about, okay? So here in this case, it will be the visible light. In the sensors capture the light in the visible range, okay? About 400 to 700 nanometers wavelength, okay? Pat, this is where the aperture of the camera is, the light enters from your camera, and here is a mirror. You guys know, I think, what I'm talking about. When you look at your viewfinder, right, you see the scene. Scene is here. When you press the shutter, guys, this mirror falls down, and actually then the light, this reflected light from the objects in the scene goes and falls onto the, and shutter is also released onto the sensor. This is how we capture a camera. Most basic camera setup is like this. This is a photosensitive plate, okay? There is a lens, you see, an aperture. And pinhole camera is the simplest model we use. You can do it through a box, a homemade, actually, pinhole camera. Like, place a, for instance, photosensitive sensor paper at the end of the box, one end. On the other end, open a hole, and then close, first make the light pass through that hole, then actually place an object, for instance, across the box. Just open this pinhole just once and just close, because then light passes and falls onto the photo plate, this photosensitive plate at the end. Of course, it's a very blurry picture. We did this experiment, I remember, with my daughter in the past. But still, you see that, you see the idea of image formation, and this creates a perspective projection. By the way, in this course, I'm giving you these as a general information. Typically, these are the contents of a 3D vision course, because 3D vision studies how this 3D object produces a 2D image on the 2D image plane, because our surroundings, right, the 3D scenes, whatever is around us, our environment, they are all in 3D. But in this 2D visual world, typically in our cameras, TVs, monitors, we capture a 2D view of the world. So there is a projection, okay? And it goes through this pinhole. So there are, of course, although it's reasonably realistic, it creates some distortions, like lens distortion. This is, for instance, if your height in 3D world, of if you have an object here, object point, it goes through this light that's reflected from this point, goes through the pinhole, and it gets actually reflected exactly onto an image pixel here. You see, this is then its position in the image plane. So there is an image plane here, okay? But you won't be responsible from this material. Like I said, I teach a 3D vision, a graduate level course. That's where we study these parameters, projection parameters like focal length, skewness, and center of projection. These are parameters, camera parameters, and what we call the intrinsic camera parameters. We try to estimate these, and that's called camera calibration. And there are also external camera parameters, like the pose of the camera in the world. Okay, but don't worry. This is, if we study this, this is really extending the course material for this level too much. That's why I give this just so that you know we have a 3D to 2D projection involved. Okay, but for this class, our goal is actually really not work with this 3D world, but goes through a lens, gets mapped onto a photosensitive sensor plate, and then actually there is all kinds of digitization. It shows here an SD card, but actually images are stored there, right? A 2D image is, you can view, is whatever light pattern falls onto such a plate. So we will be dealing mainly with 2D and video also. 3D. Actually, why not 3D also as medical images? We will see. It depends on what kind of assignments we will be preparing. But it's the same idea. Here it's X, Y, let's say. And you see each pixel has some intensity, but here it's a color actually. So we have three channels I'm going to show you. But if we have a 3D image, like a medical image, we will add one more dimension, a Z here, as depth. And we will have an image as function of X, Y, Z, okay? So image resolution is the size of the image in pixels, width and height. For instance, this image is 480 by 640. I'm sure while buying monitors, for instance, you guys see that, for instance, hey, this is a 2K. 2K pixels, that would mean, for instance, 4K, then, that would be, again, the area, the number of pixels, okay? Then, of course, there is a sampling in this 2D spatial grid, right? That determines the resolution. If I have finer grid, of course, I will have a larger picture, a finer resolution. If I have a coarser grid, like here, for instance, I will have a coarser picture, okay? For us, we will obtain images already in a sampled way. Yeah, these are some typical like daily devices that you guys have and take photos. Most of us are acquiring a lot of photos daily, posting them on social media. For instance, a typical smartphone, 8 megapixels. Now you know what this means. Of course, it has 8,000 pixels, right? Sorry, 8 million pixels, of course. You multiply these two numbers. So this is, for instance, the, let's say, X size, this is Y size, okay? Another one, okay, they have now actually larger resolution smartphones, displays are, yeah, 2 megapixels or 4 megapixels and things like that. So then there is, this was the resolution in the spatial dimension, the range of the image. No, the domain of the image, sorry. Now let's look at the range of the image. Range meaning this mapped, right, from the spatial grid coordinates, this image function I, let's say, maps to an I of XY. These are the I of XY values, right, each of these guides. Now, if I say I of XY takes or is stored in a just 8 bits per pixel, then I would have 256 different intensities, right? And this would be actually giving me intensity range 0 to 255. I can actually, if I want to represent the image with a less number of bits, let's say 4 bits per pixel, you see, this is called quantization. Even binarization, 1 bit per pixel is possible. It's just two shades, black and white. So this is also a kind of transformation, actually, intensity transformation. And in a standard color photography, we use 8 bits for each color channel, red, green, blue. These are different frequency spectrum bands. So they capture the light from different parts of the frequency spectrum or wavelength similarly. And three gives us actually three channels. For each of them, 8 bits gives us a 24-bit color, which is really good because that means 2 to the 24 different colors. And that's roughly 16.7 million colors. So we have really a very rich spectrum of color information. This is extra, but still it's good to know. Typically cameras don't have three types of, like three separate planes to capture or three different sensors. We have one sensor plane, but we use filters. This is called mosaicing because these filters are interleaving each other. Like there is, for instance, this one, which only passes through red light. This other one, so three filters. You see this one passes green and the third one passes only blue. So in the end, this gRGBG pattern. So you see a block here, a 2x2 block has two greens and one red and one blue. This is actually mosaic image. Then from here, guys, by interpolation, we extract actually the same size, green, red, and blue. That's how we obtain the RGB image. Okay? So it's like from this 2x2 block, we fill in a 2x2 red and do the same for blue and then green. You can see these videos for further information. For us, in the end, we end up with this red, green, and blue channel meaning image matrices, actually, three of them, okay, to work with. So here they are. For instance, for this overall color picture, we have the red channel, blue, green channel, and blue channel. Combining them together produces the final color. Of course, this is a way of displaying them. Normally, we see here just a set of numbers, right? These are all matrices. You will be working with these in the class. So RGB color space, it's called additive mixing of red, green, and blue. It's an additive color space. So you see, you can imagine you are in a 3D RGB space. One axis is red, one axis is green, the third is blue. And each point here will be a color value, right? And it will have an RGB value, which ranges from 0 to 255. So a color vector is represented in this way, okay? Okay, so here is like a set of actually main colors and their, what are their RGB values, vector values, okay? For instance, if it's 000, it's a dark, or I mean, it's a black. Color 255, 255, 255 is a white, so that's how it's actually adding. So if it's just, for instance, 255 here, then we would see, you see this guy 255 00, that's a red. But if we start adding to each channel 255, that's a white. So for instance, 255 red, 255 green, and 0 blue gives me yellow. So that's why it takes the name additive color mixing. Okay? Yeah, it gives this color sear. You will see these, so you will have an idea. Okay? And there are other color spaces. There is a huge field called color science, by the way. For instance, this is an important color space. It's in this time, it represents our 3D color vector by HSV. This is thought to be more perceptually relevant because there is a hue channel, the first component. It corresponds to the discernible color. So, for instance, redness, greenness, or blueness, hue. Okay. And then there is saturation, corresponds to the vividness of color. We sometimes say it's really low saturation. It's like pastel colors, but it can be high saturation. It's really bright. Red, for instance, it's a bright red. V is the value corresponding to the brightness. That is actually really the gray value in a way, like the gray value of the color. It's the intensity of the color, okay? For instance, a bright red has a red hue, full saturation, and a high value. So other color spaces also exist, but in this course we'll mainly work in RGB color space. However, you may be required to transform to other spaces such as SV, HSV, but we will give you the formula or the conversion tool. So don't worry. It will depend on the assignments that we are currently preparing with Yusuf. There may be color processing problems. So for instance, if let's say this is my original RGB image, I would like to ask you, now think of the hue saturation value, HSV color space. Which one of the following do you think is the hue channel? Remember, hue is actually corresponds to the perceived color. Okay, so let's continue. We were here and now. So there are other types of images like RGBD. This is like the Kinect. Most of you are probably familiar with. In addition to RGB, it also acquires a depth image with a laser-like scanner, light rays that bounce from the environment. And for instance, here is an input image. Here is a depth image formed from the actual this type of sensor. So it gives us an extra information, this third dimension, okay? So volumetric images, like I said, if you've ever been to an MR machine, CT machine, you've seen this, probably you've seen your own MR images. These are MR images of the brain. You see different slices of the brain from the side actually in this way, okay? Then the video sequence we said is also 2D images stacked over time, okay? So now let's start with our point processing because we would like to take an image, let's say it's something like this, and we would like to change its brightness, for instance, towards brighter, less brighter, do a gamma, something called a gamma correction. It will be all about actually transforming a pixel's intensity value as a function of its intensity value alone. That's why it's called point-wise processing or point processing. So let's say this is the identity, the linear transform, or actually there won't be any change on this linear line. I mean, not linear transform on this linear line, but we can design different types of functions on there, okay? Types of functions to be able to transform this x-axis is the input, guys, input image, input intensities. The y-axis are the output intensities. Input maps to the output through the function. Of course, here it will be through a different function. And you will be designing those functions. We design, okay? And output corresponds to 0 to n dynamic range. N is the dynamic range of the display device. Typically 255. But still, just to point out, it could be a general or other number. Input is also typically 0 to 255. So let's see these different types of point processing. We can do brightness and contrast adjustment, gamma correction, histogram equalization. I really believe you guys are using these in tools, ready-made, right? But here in this course, you see you will be able to design, implement these from scratch. So again, then our operation is really to be able to design some function like this, this blue curve here. It's a point operation or point operator, let's say phi or phi. I is the input image, j is the output image. So we have a mathematical operation that operates on the range of the image, intensity actually, okay? So at each point over the image, this would mean in my grid, 2D grid, I go to a pixel value, sample its I, intensity I, and then through this function phi or f, if you view it as an operator, it's phi, or function f, I'm actually making an f of I transform and producing a j image, okay? J image intensity value at the same row and column, for instance, same RC point. And we can do this in one band image, like I said, grayscale images. So here is the input I of RC at pixel location RC. Apply the same F, for instance, to all IRCs or all pixel locations, of course, and obtain, create a new image, okay? And if it's a three channel image, I can do the same over all the bands, for instance, or I can just maybe apply to go to the, for instance, saturation value and just apply to the value band. For instance, that's one possibility, okay? Each map can, yeah, band can be mapped through a separate function, or all three bands are mapped through the same function. We can create a lookup table, okay? Point operations using lookup tables, meaning for this transform, f of, let's say g is the gray value. Let's assume now we have a one band channel, okay? For each actually gray value to be transformed by f, I can create or transform g by f of g, create a k, and write these into a lookup table actually. So then I have, let's say if it's a 0 to 255 values, right, 256 by one array, it gives me each, for instance, what is 0 is mapping to, what is 1 is mapping to, and things like that. Okay, I mean, it goes on similarly. So then if I can form a lookup table, it's really easy to transform my image. Lookup table of I over intensities will give me J. If it's a three band image, you can do the same for each band, either through different lookup tables or one for each band. So here is the idea. X axis is the input values, Y axis are the output values. So map these. So this function F, guys, you see this black curve here. For instance, this is one example. It gives me how to map, for instance, let's say this is value 100, okay, here. It tells me how to map this guy to a new number. You see, it's mapped to a lower number here. So we will, you have to understand what kind of effect this pointwise operation is doing. So this looks like a little bit like a sigmoid function. We will show its mathematical formula. Okay, but the point is, you see, let's say this was really 101 index, I mean, intensity value was 101, okay, here. And it's through this functional mapping, it mapped to 64. Okay, you see 100 to 68. So everybody here is mapped to a darker, what we call a smaller or smaller intensity values correspond to darker, because zero intensity means there is no light falling there, right? That's the darkest. 255, we map it to the brightest intensity value. So you see, our larger intensity values are mapped to lower intensities. Okay, what would this effect be? Similarly, actually, if for instance, I had, let's say here 180, I'm just making up a number, and I would read, let's say 200. Okay, so this would mean I'm making the brights brighter, darks darker. Okay, and as you see here, this is the similar curve, same curve. Okay, a pixel with, let's say from here, a 64 intensity value is mapped to a 32 value. So what kind of effect does this lookup table then have, or this functional mapping have? It enhances the contrasts, right? Make brights brighter, darks darker, increases contrast, exactly. It's an contrast increasing functional mapping. So then with a given mathematical functional intensity mapping like this, you can, because you can think of, for instance, a sigmoid like curve, right? Remember, this is my, this models, this function is one way to model such a sigmoid looking curve, light, right? And A is a parameter here. It tells me how sharp this, how steep this middle part goes up. Right, it could be sharper here, steeper, or it could be like more shallower, right? So then I can create a lookup table very easily, create an array, right? First create X, this all this range, this vector of 0 to 256, okay? And then for instance, choose a parameter A, let's say it's 2. It's really here in Python, the implementation of this guy, okay? NumPy, use NumPy's exponential. And you have to, of course, center your curve. Here it's centered at 127. And let's see, there is, I'm seeing, okay, this was already given. This is actually another parameter, of course. It could have been inside A, but it's given separately here. It's fine. This is just one example, exactly. So let's see. For instance, to increase brightness, you can do other things. This way, for instance, this is another curve. So another possibility. This one just shifts, of course, all the intensities up, right, by a value G. Let's see here, G, what is it, the G value? It is not written here, but you can see the effect from this image, original image. It is blocking partially the other one, but it's really increasing the brightness to the bright side, but it's not doing contrast increase here. In the other one, because darks were also made darker, right? Darks were suppressed and brights were increased. Here it's really pushing everybody to the bright side. That's why actually it has this more pale looking way. It looks like a little bit washed out. So, okay, you see the effect here. For instance, this is now going to the other side. Do you guys see how the curve changes, right? This curve, please take a look. You see, I had a functional mapping in this way. Now I have the functional mapping, which this time actually pushes everybody to the dark side. To the dark, this is like my comment looked like, sounded like Star Wars, but this is now, you see my actually whites or not whites, but brights are, for instance, these, let's say I had a 250 intensity value in the original image. Now it is mapped to, I read off the value, something like 130, 140, okay? So these are, of course, parameters, what number to subtract, okay? You should also see the clipping here. Typically for our displays, we don't keep negative values. So we need to always do a clipping between 0 to 255, okay? That's used exactly here. This is the clipping part of this function. So for instance, I can ask you this, given intensity transform here, this is the this time intensity transform. Input is mapped to the output with this transform. Then let's say this is my input image. It is transferred to this one or the left one or the right one. Which one do you think? Now have an idea. Go to, for instance, 255. That's, let's say, some pixel from here. What is it mapped to? Mapped to zero, right? So which one then, the right or the left? The right, right? This guy. I mean, the brights are mapped to black. Now let's find maybe some blacker parts in these windows or here. Let's see this block here, and it's mapped to the other way around, the dark, the bright, right? Okay, I hope it's clear. So here, until here, guys, I showed you ways where this function was designed by you, this mapping function. We can also look at the probability density function of images or histogram, the unnormalized PDF, and we can try to come up with these functional mappings using the histogram of the image, okay? So what is a PDF? First of all, I always start by reminding you which is the probability density function that can be described by just two parameters. Exactly, normal, right? It has it's this guy actually. So remember, it has a mean, which is the most likely value of this Gaussian density. I mean, here it was Gaussian distribution. They are the equivalent, remember, distribution and density function. Maybe before this, I can remind you of the definition of PDF. It's any function, a PDF, probability density function, is any function that is non-negative. So f of x should be greater or equal to zero for all x, and whose area or integral equals to one, okay? And then it's giving me likelihood of observing a value x, right, in my data distribution, input distribution or intensity distribution. So for instance, probability of variable x being within the interval AB, x is a random variable. Here I'm talking about x being our intensity value. If it's in the interval AB, I can calculate the probability of or the likelihood that I find my x value in between A and B. Okay. And we typically find estimates the easiest way, the most rough way finding estimates to PDF is through histogram. And then we can, how can we convert it to a PDF? We can normalize it. Yeah, you should know, of course, Gaussian by heart. I mean, it's the most widely used probability density function or distribution in probably in both mathematics and in real life. Because it has this typical value mu, right? It is centered around that. And then there is the spread sigma, the standard deviation. So it's really very, very useful, very widely used. Gaussian density distribution are equivalent. Just recall the difference between them. If I take a cumulative integration of this guy, right? I get a distribution, CDF. Cumulative density function, distribution function. So how to calculate the histogram? Because now, remember, we say these are quantized, both spatially quantized, sampled. So that means I have a spatial grid here, right? Grid where in each grid, I also have a quantized intensity. Let's say I have a 4-bit image to make this simpler. So it's a 16-level intensity. Gives me a 16-level intensity range. From G or gray value, let's say gray 0 to gray 1, 2, 3 until 15. Now I can actually start counting how many pixels take the value 0 because I'm trying to find the likelihood, right, of gray value 0 finding. So that would mean if I randomly sample an intensity value from this image, just go to a pixel randomly, sample its intensity, read it off. For instance, what's the likelihood that I will read off 5? To find that, I can first count the number of pixels that have G equals 5, right? And then I can normalize this value by the whole count of pixels. So in the end, my PDF would be 2237, for instance, over whatever is the size of this image. Actually, however many pixels I have currently, I didn't write. Because I only know it's a 4-bit image, 16 level, but here you see we are not given the size of the image. Okay, so that would give me the probability that the any gray value I sample has an intensity value of 5. Is that clear? This should be very clear for you. Histogram is an important measure in data science, important actually. Function that we use or way of measuring the actually probability is in a way unnormalized probabilities of data. Okay, and then for a grayscale image, this is trying to say create a vector histogram of 256 by 1 vector and count the number of big pixels that have value G, for instance. So for instance, this is the final histogram from our counts. Like I said, for instance, let's say here H histogram of the 12th vector index, it gives me actually the gray value 11, okay? The likelihood, or actually here the histogram count for gray value 11 is actually the gives us the maximum count. This is the, you remember, mode of this distribution. You should remember these. Probability theory is very important for you in throughout your career, whether you are a scientist, academician, or an engineer in industry, okay? So this is mode of the histogram. You should know how to create or convert this thing to a PDF approximator, okay? But you can see, the nice thing about histogram is I can see the distribution, right, in a way, how my gray values are actually distributed. I mean, how many, for instance, or which pixel values, gray values are more likely to see. I can see these G 10, 11, 12 are more likely. I have lower probabilities for these darker values. Because remember from the picture, actually, there are more brights because background is bright. There are very bright spots on this bug. Yeah, there are also very dark, these legs of the bug, antennas. So there are also very dark pixels. Okay, darks are around here and brights, you see, have a more mass, in the PDF in a way. Okay, huh? Exactly. It's trying to show which gray value has which histogram value. Now, for instance, this is a given, let's say, grayscale image. Now you can plot its histogram and you can see the distribution, statistical distribution. So this is really nice, actually. You can get an idea about the statistical characteristics of the intensities, right? That's why it's important. Then you can look at things like mean standard deviation. For instance, mean pixel is 105 intensity level. Mean intensity level, sorry. Standard deviation is 45. So somewhere here. Median is 96. Again, somewhere here, you see. And it's sampled here, one value. It's, I think, 207. And it has count for 96. And we can calculate the percentile. So meaning from the CDF, remember, 94.47% of this count is on the left side of this pixel. That's the CDF value, right? 0.94. I mean, for color image, it's then really no-brainer. I will quickly go over these such slides. It says you can do this for three color channels differently, okay? So either you can get a gray value histogram like this, luminosity also. Sometimes we call it brightness channel, luminosity channel, luminance channel, or a value, gray value channel. This guy, I will show you how to obtain it. We can obtain it in the most easiest way as a, for instance, average of the three channels. But you see, typically, these red, green, blue histograms also somewhat, not exactly actually, but somewhat follow the same pattern. You see, the mass of the intensities are concentrated around here, hundreds intensity value. You may be wondering, why are we talking about this at this point? We were talking about intensity transformation of images, point transform, because now we will devise from the probability theory, we will derive and borrow a theorem, and we will automatically come up with these functional mappings based on the probability density function or the CDF, okay? The histograms. Those will be through histogram equalization and histogram matching. So because you can, once you analyze your image characteristics, intensity characteristics through this histogram or the approximate PDF, you can see, the intensities are not really that nicely distributed. It's using most of the mainly, these hundreds intensity levels. It's concentrated around there. Maybe I can try to spread it out to be able to increase the contrast or make it more pleasing, okay? So this is what I just said before, a slide for you, how to find the gray value, V. You can simply take an average, or from color science, we borrow these numbers according to the dominance of each spectrum, green, red, green, blue. You see green is at the center. It takes more part of this visible light spectrum. So for instance, these color scientists or physics actually gives us a more weight, 0.59 and then 0.3 and 0.11 for red and blue respectively. So you can also do a weighted addition to find the luminance value of the image. Then you, this is another image, right? Luminance or gray image. Now you can do histogram calculations on L or V. Then these are, you see, histogram of blue, green, red, and the luminance channel in black. Again, these are all jagged because it's all quantized, right? I mean, normally PDFs are, we model them in mathematics in a continuous world, but we have here a very digitized image. It's called also digitization, of course. We have sampled pixel space plus quantized intensity space. Some calculator, you guys can, you will be working on this in your first homework in Python, okay? Exactly, with histogram equalization, histogram matching, and things like that. So I won't be redoing this. This is probably a very basic Python code for you. Exactly, try to find all those intensity values that are equal to G, for instance. If I'm trying to find the G histogram value, the gray level G, then sum it up over the whole image, right? Because it's a 2D image, you sum twice, right? Let's see. For each band, yes, one number. And then to go to from histogram to the normalized histogram, which is an approximator to the probability density function, you have to really normalize by A, which is total number of pixels in the image, okay? So this slide is trying to say, give you again the intuition of what is PI of G. It's the probability density function. So fraction of pixels, or I sometimes call probability, right? Probability that a pixel randomly selected from the given image has intensity value G, okay? The probability distribution function, or the CDF, also known as cumulative distribution function. What is its definition? Do you guys remember? It is, remember, the cumulative or running sum, in a way, of this PDF. So it's like, for instance, to find the cumulative density at 100, I find the area to the left of this PDF, remember? So it tells me this time the probability that a pixel, again, I randomly select, let's say G equals 100, okay? Then CDF tells me the probability that that pixel has an intensity value less than or equal to G. That's the only difference, okay? CDF or PDF, we call it. So for instance, this is an image, given image. You can see that you are not really satisfied with this image, right? It's looks like has a this washed out appearance, very dull appearance. It's not using really the intensity range nicely. Your first thing you should do is look at its PDF, right? Probability density function or histogram. Start with histogram to be able to really see or verify your observation that the intensities are really concentrated in a small band range, and it's not really used wisely. It's not using the whole range. So, and then this histogram really tells you that. You see here the intensities are closely here concentrated around this time, let's say 160 intensity value. Guys, you see this grading here from zero dark, how it looks like this part box shows us how these intensity values look like in the image, dark to bright and all the grays in between. Histogram has 256 pins, okay? Exactly, most intensities are clustered in the range 100, 200, exactly around this area. It looks washed out. Image lacks darker values and very bright values. So now, normalize this histogram, try to come up with a PDF. This is how you normalize it. Now we here, this time we read likelihood, right? The probability. So a pixel in this image has a higher probability, you see, of having 160 intensity value. Look at it. The probability is, let's say, 0.035. Then having a value of 200, having probably value of 200, intensity is very, very low, probably like 10 to the minus 3, okay? You see, it really gives us a lot of information. Now, a basic thing you can do, you can use histogram just to analyze the intensities and come up with a basic transform like this. Say, use device this affine function, what you will learn what is affine. It looks like linear, but there is alpha I plus beta, okay? So scaling plus some bias. Looking at maybe this histogram picture, you can come up with these the scale alpha and beta, okay? Now you can transform with this transformation, and I gave this as an exercise. Plot the given point-wise transformation. Look at this form with alpha 2, beta equals minus 200. What type of intensity function, transforming function you would see, please tell me. And there is also clipping, remember, that is very important. So that will look like something like this, right? Some zeros, some straight or linear part and then two clipped parts. Okay. So now these numbers, of course, these are cherry picked, meaning carefully designed. From the given image, we can transform, you see, stretch the contrast. It's stretching because you see now it goes all the way to zero. It uses intensity values from zero to 255, although less number of pixels there. But what I was saying is check the histogram, what is not shown in the above transform, because I would obtain some negative and values of intensities and some greater than 255s, but we take care of those, of course. Okay, it's really clipped because we try to keep the range in a 8-bit storage space. Okay, of the intensity. Is this clear going from here to here? You can create a lookup table from this formula with these parameters. Okay, here I mean it's instead of a lookup table. It just does this through vector operations in Python. You can use this CV. There is an open CV library. You can use it to also display images, for instance, with ImShow. Okay. So you see, guys, these are and other types of transfer, increase contrast, for instance, transform functions. The other one also looks like this, actually. It's just rewriting that this guy can be rewritten in this way with different parameters, of course. So this is the form of this transform. Okay, centered around 127, and A is the parameter here. It's greater than one. So now it's when it's greater than, the slope is greater than one, because when slope is one, it's the identity transform, nothing changes. Slope is greater than one now. There is, with clipping, this guy is really, again, increasing contrast because brights are brighter, darks are darker. Of course, you have to do this carefully. But then I can do this other way around, you see, with A less than one, between zero and one. Now I can decrease the contrast. And you can all track these, what is happening to the image through this histogram or PDF, approximate PDF, okay? We can increase and decrease contrast all by, you see, playing with the parameters here. So this is the most basic form of, you see, the functions and how actually now the histogram is this time pushed to the bright side, right? It was on the dark side, now it's pushed to the bright side. Contrast stretch, this time we use the min and max values of the input image, and then we say for the target intensity image, we also set min and max. Let's see. Yeah, exactly. These will be set. This little mj and capital mj are set by you, and little mi and capital mi are, of course, given by the input image. And then you again design. You see, this time the form of the transform is given again similarly in this form, but we have two levels here, and this is called, this range is called window, this little mi to capital mi, and you see they are mapped to little mj and capital mj. Here it's 0 to 255, but if my image only took values between the minimum I and maximum I, now it's mapped to stretch to 0 to 255. That's why it's called contrast stretch. And also the level here determines the slope of this curve, okay? So in medical imaging, this is called window and level, but here it's called contrast stretch. All these parameters, here the parameters are actually, since MI and these two MIs are given, MJ, and MJ are the parameters, and slope is defined by the actually these four parameters, right? So think of what this function is doing. It's really taking the minimum to the desired minimum, minimum of the input to the desired minimum at the output, maximum of the input to the desired maximum at the output, and thus a contrast stretching. So this is the last functional form, gamma correction, called, it's a, the name gamma correction comes from TV times, from the monitors of the old times, probably 30, 40 years ago, 50 years ago. But the important thing here is actually the functional form. It's this way, I over some normalization divided by its maximum. Here it's, you see, to the power, the exponent is 1 over gamma, okay? And here is its Python implementation. Let's say it has, I mean, it's somehow interpreted by the human perception. I think we should take these by some caution, okay? But important thing is this. This is doing some gamma correction. I think here we should just look at the mathematics. This is the functional form depending on gamma. Because it's 1 over gamma, when gamma is greater than 1, we have, you see, this curved functional mapping. And it's when we say, because we want to say increased gamma, you see, this is mapping all the intensities in the horizontal plane here to a brighter, towards more brighter values. That's why it's increased gamma and gamma correction. Now do the other way around. Look at a curve like this. You see now, this curve will map everything towards darker values, right? So if I had a 127, let's say, intensity value, it's not mapped to 127, but it's now mapped to 100, let's say. Okay, so you see the histograms, how the histograms change. It was on the dark, bright side, now it's on the dark side. And please remember these forms of the functions, okay? So effect on the histogram, exactly the original image, let's say, was distributed, its intensities are distributed in this way. This is with increased gamma. You see gamma is 2 greater than 1. Intensities are shifted to the right. Now gamma equals half, a half intensities are shifted to the left, okay? I think this slide nicely explains the effect on the image, both visually and also on the density. So this is another transform actually, which is called this quantization transform in a way. So it's all these stairways, piecewise continuous functions, okay? So everything in between this range, for instance, is mapped to a 1. Everything in this range is mapped to a 2. So it's mapping, let's say, from 0 to 255, this gray image, to, I'm asking you, then which of these images? This is quantization, and let's say I'm giving you this quantized, this quantization functional mapping or transformation. Which one do you think? Just think of how many levels are there at the output, right? It's everything in this range. For instance, I'm making this up, but 220 to 255, they are all mapped to 8. 8 levels, right? So this image has 2 levels. This seems to me it has at least 16 or maybe 32 levels. It has more gray variations. This looks like it has 8, actually, this one. So try to count very bright, 2, 6, yeah, 8, this one, okay? This is 3 bits per chip. I mean, this is another way to show. It's a 3-bit image, okay? Are we following, guys? Is this clear for everybody? Okay. All right. Okay. Sorry. Let's see. Histogram equalization. Now, this is important. We call from parabolic theory this theorem, very important theorem. Please remember this. You should have learned this. If you plug in a random variable into its own CDF, you get a uniform distribution. So when I say histogram equalization, our goal is to be able to use all the intensity values somewhat similarly, okay, uniformly. So that gives me a uniform distribution. I'm trying to convert my histogram, for instance, here. This histogram, let's say, I try to convert it to a uniform distribution, okay? So Now I will use this probability theorem, which tells me how I can get a uniform distribution so that I want to remap my image so that its histogram is as close to uniform as possible. To do that, I need to find or calculate the cumulative distribution function, CDF, of my image, okay? Because then if I transform my input image, exactly this line here, this formula tells me what I should do using this probability theorem. I think this was called probability integral transform. Transform my input image by its CDF. This capital P is the CDF symbol, or remember. So CDF itself is used as the lookup transform, a lookup table. And this, because now this becomes between 0 and 1, we also multiply by 255 to make it 0 to 255. So this is it. Now with CDF in place, we can transform the image exactly like this. Let's see. Here, this code is just for plotting the histogram, by the way, as you can see. But the idea, once we do that transform, will be to be able to map this input image on the left to the image on the in the middle. CDF is computed. So this was the PDF of this image, right? No, actually, this is quite equalized. This is PDF of this middle histogram equalized image, and this is its CDF. It tries to achieve a fillet histogram, of course, and all image intensities are used in equal amounts. Ideally, I should have a flat histogram and I should have a linear CDF, but of course, these are all quantized sampled images. I don't have it in this case, but I try to get close as much as possible. So here, for instance, this is the input image. This is its PDF or histogram. This is the after the CDF transformation, okay, which is called histogram equalization. And we get, when we calculate its PDF or histogram and plot it, you see now I started to use most of the gray values quite equally. Okay, that's the idea. Now, you can create or use the CDF as the lookup table. This is what it's trying to say. Now, it's trying to say, if you want to histogram equalize this left top image, calculate its PDF. So this is the normalized histogram. Look at these values. They are not counts, but they are normalized by area of the histogram. So they are probabilities now. Later, calculate your CDF, which is take a cumulative running integral over this PDF to get the CDF. You remember CDF always has this monotonic increasing form between 0 and 1. And now convert the CDF to a lookup table. Now read off any value. You see, this is your input range. So I mean, guys, now this is CDF is really your intensity transform. You see, now we obtained this intensity transformation from the image statistics itself, image PDF and CDF itself. So lookup table. Now I can see, for instance, let's say I had actually here, let's see, a lot of values around, let's say 60, 70. Okay, those guys, so things were a little bit concentrated over the darker side, right? Smaller intensities, but you see now it's stretching them. For instance, 70 is mapped to 110, let's say. You see, it's really starting to use the whole range. You can see this effect. Here, it's stretched here on this bright side also. It's really for all these large values, it's mapping to the larger intensity values here. And for the equalized image histogram, is looking more spread than the original image histogram. Okay. These effects are due to the, like I said, quantizedness and sampled image. We are living a digital or discrete space here. That's why it's not a continuous space we are working with, right? Normally, of course, in real life, these are all physical things, but in our computers we are working with a digitized variables. That's why we get these like jigged looking histograms. It's fine. So this is another question I wanted to ask you. Let's say I have three images given. This is, I think, from either the moon, moon surface, I think, some craters, and three different versions of that image, and three PDFs and their CDFs also. So you can imagine one of them is histogram equalized, right? This guy, it's at least tried to spread the intensities, and its CDF should be closest to a linearly increasing slope, right, or form. So which one matches which? Let's try to understand. Which one looks to use both brights and darks? Which one looks to have only a low range of intensities? To me, this guy, for instance, guys, it must be this, right? Because it has a lot of gray intensities. That's the dominant. Grays are really, middle grays are the concentrated intensity values. And this should be really, its PDF should be really this guy. Okay, what else? I'm thinking A is 2 and C is 1. This is looking to me more like contrast enhanced. Histogram equalized. Okay, you guys can do. Now you can study that on your own, okay? And ask us if there is a problem. Please try to figure it out. So now this is the last type of intensity transform we will be studying. Our goal is remap an image so that it has the same histogram as much as possible as image J, okay? So it's not possible to make them, of course, exactly equal. Like I said, we are in a digital world here, but still as much as possible. How can we do this matching? Again, we will be using this probability theorem similarly. In practice, it will be by matching percentiles over the CDF, but let's first define the problem again. There is an original image, let's say on the left, then there is a target image because it's a matching, right? So now we would like this guy, the original, to have a similar intensity distribution as this target image. You see, then we have to design a histogram matching or a transformation, intensity transformation, so that I can map this original image to the one on the right, okay? I mean, at least in terms of brightness, it looks like the target image more, okay, than itself. So how do we do this? Actually, we can remember what we did in histogram equalization. This is a nice, actually, intuition I can share with you. I put the website here down. So the nice thing is here, remember, for histogram equalization, we were trying to go from the original histogram or PDF to the equalized PDF, meaning uniform distribution, right? So I have a forward mapping, remember, by the CDF, right? This is, let's say, T1 of gray value S, or here it said R, another variable. Now we have a target specified. I'm trying to match this original histogram or PDF to the specified or target image PDF. Okay, so you see, original has gray values more concentrated on the bright or larger intensity values. The target has more, actually, somewhat more concentrated on the lower intensity values. So I can actually also convert or transform this target to the uniform distribution through its own CDF, which is through T2. Let's say that's transform 2. So both are doing forward transform to the uniform PDF. Now I can, from the uniform PDF by T2 inverse, go back to the target image, target PDF. This is exactly the idea, okay? I hope this is clear for everybody. This is very important. Like I said, these are more general mathematics and data science problems, not specific to vision. Any questions? Okay. All right. So, guys, for instance, here is a nice simple example. Suppose the VIX pixel value 10 in the original image. It gets mapped to 20 in the equalized image. Okay, from here 20. And then in the target image, let's say we want to find what this 20 gets mapped to. That's why we use 2-2 inverse, okay? Let's say it was 28. 28 was mapped to 20. So now I know 10 is mapped to 28. That's the idea, okay? So that's what we call also matching percentiles in a practical way. We find the CDFs, and I think we shouldn't read this, but it's shown here much easily, graphically, very clearly, I mean. So to create an image K, target image, the destination image K, transformed image from image I, such that K has nearly the same CDF as image J. J is the target image, okay? We do this. This is the CDF of image I. This is the CDF of the target image J, okay? So I have on my CDF, let's say gray value 5. It has a certain percentile, right? We call this percentile. This is called the likelihood or probability that the value 5, when I sample a gray value 5, the intensity values being less than or equal to 5, right? Is the probability of that is equal to, let's say, 0.65. I'm just trying to read it off here, but something like that, 0.65. Now, like we've seen from the theory, in the practice, what we do is go to the target CDF and try to read off which intensity value maps to that specific percentile or CDF value, which is 0.65. So you see that intensity value 5, remember our horizontal axis are the intensity values to be mapped. The 5 gets mapped to 10. Okay, now we can create a lookup table from that. I hope it's clear. I can do the same with others. Maybe for 2, it's 0.4 percentile, okay? Probability in the CDF is 0.4. So I want to know which value this 2 maps to. Go here, 0.4. It falls into 7. So it maps into intensity 7, for instance, okay? So now you can write the histogram matching algorithm. This is how you would do it in a more for and while, with for and while loops. You see, the goal is to fill in the destination image K, which is the transformed image from I, right, to K, knowing or following the look appearance of target image J. So this is matching image I to J, okay? So for instance, let's see an example. This is an image with intensity 16 values just for the sake of simpleness, okay? Typically we have 8-bit, of course, 256, but let's just go with this now. So we calculate its PDF first, okay? Now you know how to do this. You calculate its histogram, normalize the histogram, then find the probability density function of I, which is PDF I. And you see the dark side, like one, for instance, in the sky on the this rocket, it has a lot of probability, like high probability, because we see it more, it has more likelihood. Calculate the CDF from PDF, okay? Cumulative distribution function for this image. Now take a targets image. Let's say this is again another target with 16 intensity values, and this time we see this picture has a more brighter appearance, right? And it's statistical measures, which is here the histogram or PDF, shows this to us. You see these larger intensity values have larger probabilities, okay? It's MODIS, at least, for instance, with G equals 11, that has the largest intensity, the probability, and its mean will be also towards the brighter side. Now calculate target CDF, look at the difference between CDF of the input and CDF of the targets. Its form of the CDFs are very different. Now we will match the input CDF to this, let's see. We have to create a lookup table, okay? And let's see how we can create the lookup table. Let's see the graphics on the next slide. Rather than reading this, you can use it. This is the way to create lookup table. Calculate the input image CDF, target image CDF, and really for each of the possible intensities on this horizontal axis, create its corresponding mapped image value. For instance, 4 maps to 10, because I'm really matching the percentiles or the CDF probabilities, right? So 0.6, you see it really involves the percentile actually for the 10, grade 10. So 4 maps to 10, do this for each of these intensities. Now I have a lookup table, meaning horizontal axis, the input intensities are mapped to this vertical axis, the output intensities, okay? Now this is really here stored in a vector of 16 dimension. Of course, in our images, it's a 256 real, mostly used RGB images. Here we are using, working on their gray, but you can do this for each color channel. This is how you would do it by a while loop and for loop, creating a lookup table. You can probably do these in a vectorized form too, but reading off from CDF and matching percentiles. Now, when we do this matching through and we pass our input image I through this lookup table, guys, this is the resulting image CDF. You see, of course, it's not, it cannot be the same. We are not working in a continuous world and all digitized world. Here you see still the form. This was the input image CDF. Now when it's transformed, its CDF looks like this, and it's really looking like, resembling the target CDF. And let's look at again the image corresponding to, actually the image corresponding to this CDF is this guy, okay? Now with the RGB image, we can do different things. For instance, color image, if this was on the left, my original image, we can do play with actually different channels. For instance, I can match the red CDF, red channel CDF to the blue channel CDF. You see now we have a more bluish looking image. I can match this in this original image, the green channel CDF to the red channels. Now you see I have a reddish looking image. Here I have a greener looking image. So you see you can actually obtain very interesting or different widely varying type of result, appearance results. So for a color image, you can go and calculate the histograms for each channel separately, red PDF, green PDF, blue PDF, and luminosity or gray value PDF. Find their CDFs, okay? Then do the same for the target image. This is the target image. It's PDFs first. You see how the red is actually, it's a very reddish looking image, right? So you see it's PDF is really concentrated on the bright red side. It's CDF in each channel. Now, here what it did was mapped the, found the lookup table through the value or gray luminosity channel and applied that lookup table to each of the red, green, blue. This is the result, luminosity remap. Okay, so then we say the luminance characteristics of this target is passed to the original, which is fine. So this was what we've seen already, luminosity remap. These are the CDFs and lookup table and its effects on the PDFs and CDFs, okay? So let's see. For instance, we should look at this at least slide because it says shows us how the CDFs change. Important thing is you see the CDFs really now look like from here to here, look, they all look like this target CDF, right? Which is what we wanted. To have the RGB CDF of another. Let's see. I think this time, guys, these are all we should, you should try. Get your hands dirty. This time we map R to R, G to G, B to B. Okay? From this image, map its red channel to the red channel of this guy. Now we see more reddish, which makes sense, right? Because red is mapped to the red of this guy, which was really dominantly on the bright red side. Green is mapped to its green, blue is mapped to its blue. Please try to understand clearly what is the difference from what I just showed you. There we were using the luminance channel transformation as a lookup, but here we have three lookup tables, okay? Red to red, green to green, blue to blue. Now we see more reddish, which makes sense. Here the effect was more on the luminance, brightness type, right? Luminance effect. Do you see the difference? I hope it's clear. Okay. And then the effect is also here explored in the CDFs. Okay. And RGB remapping. So it's all done on separately, how the PDFs are changed, how the CDFs are changed. This is very nice. Actually, it's nice because you will have some time for the, I will have some time for your questions and you have some time for the quiz, which is good. So let's finish this up. So we've done in terms of your learning objectives. First week was main problems of computer vision, its uses and applications. Today at the end, I assume, hopefully we covered these image transforms, particularly point-wise transforms, that is intensity transforms. You can do some reading from your books. There is this Kletta book and Gonzalez and Woods.